This screencast is for Lesson 22, Exploring Igneous Rock Formation. The first part of this lesson, we need to talk a little bit about some terms related to solutions. First of all, a solvent is a substance that dissolves another substance. A solute is a substance that's dissolved in the solvent. Now, notice that this is not the word solute, as in salute in the military, but it's pronounced solute. This is what is dissolved in the solvent. A solution is a mixture that forms when a gas, liquid, or solid disperses evenly without a chemical change. Solutes, solvents, and solutions can all be solids, liquids, or gases. We normally think of solutions as being liquids, but a gas solution that you may not realize is the air that you breathe. It's made up of oxygen gas, nitrogen gas mostly, but it also includes carbon dioxide, water vapor, and all these things are mixed together to make a gas solution. A solid solution could be brass, and brass is actually a mixture of two different metals, nickel and copper. Some other examples that we gave up here are salt, which is our solute, dissolves in water, which is our solvent, and it produces a solution of salt water. Over here we said whipped cream, which would be our solute, dissolves in hot chocolate, which would be our solvent, and it produces a solution of even yummier hot chocolate. Let's see if I can move this over so you can see. There we go. Even yummier hot chocolate. Okay, so we also need to talk a little bit about crystals. Crystals are solid substances with regular geometric shapes. They often precipitate from a solution, which means they come out of a solution when the liquid evaporates, and lock together like pieces of a three-dimensional puzzle. And I drew a picture to show you this process. So if we have a beaker of salt water and we let some time go by, the water will eventually evaporate and the salt crystals will precipitate out or come out of the solution and be left behind at the bottom of the beaker. You may have done an experiment similar to this before. Okay, the rest of this lesson is two articles that you read about. One was Earth's Water Works, and this talks about the different water features that can be created from ancient heat underground or magma chambers underground. And so a geyser is a spring that spouts hot water and steam, and that water is heated from magma deep underneath the earth. Yellowstone National Park is an area in Wyoming and Montana with over 10,000 geothermal features. And it has so many hot springs because most of Yellowstone sits inside an ancient caldera. And we know that a caldera is a part of, or what used to be part, of a volcano. And all this rock underneath Earth's surface has stayed hot for thousands of years. Old Faithful is a geyser in Yellowstone that erupts on such a regular basis, every 79 minutes in fact, that's how it got its name. And we also have things called bubbling mud pots that can form when hot springs become choked with sediment and rock. A fumarole is superheated water that rises and erupts as a burst of steam instead of a burst of water. And there was a geyser named Pork Chop in Yellowstone that had channels and cracks that became clogged, then it erupted large rocks because of the built-up pressure, and then it eventually stopped altogether. All right, last thing is the rock cycle. And there are many forces that are responsible for moving rocks from one place to another. Some of these forces include wind, water, volcanic eruptions, plate movements. And the three basic types of rock that are getting moved around are igneous, sedimentary, and metamorphic. How do igneous rocks form? Well, we've talked about it before, but they form when magma or lava cools and crystallizes. And then these rocks can be broken down when wind, rain, or snow erodes it, and when acid breaks it down chemically. Sedimentary rocks are formed when tiny pieces of rock and sediment become compacted and cemented together. and metamorphic rocks are formed when Earth's great temperatures or pressures change igneous or sedimentary rocks into something new. Metamorphic rocks can develop folds in them when one plate collides with another. And an igneous rock can turn into a metamorphic rock when there is high heat and pressure to squeeze it into a metamorphic rock. All right, the last slide in lesson 22 is really just an overall picture of the rock cycle. And this picture is really important to be able to understand and to be able to explain. So the first thing we have is the three types of rocks. We have igneous up here, we have sedimentary, and we have metamorphic. And then there's all these arrows pointing in different directions, but our arrows have different colors on them, signifying different things. So the first thing that I want you to see is that there are two orange arrows, actually three orange arrows, there should be a third one here, with the words melting on them. And each of these three rocks can get melted if they are transported far enough down inside the Earth. And when they melt, they become magma. That's where magma comes from. But only one rock can form when this magma cools, and that is igneous rock. So there's only one of these cooling arrows, and that points directly to the igneous rock. The other thing you'll notice is that there are two yellow arrows, and they are moving from sedimentary and igneous rocks to metamorphic rocks. That means that metamorphic rocks are formed by taking either an igneous rock or a sedimentary rock and adding lots of heat and lots of pressure to change it into a metamorphic rock. There are also three green arrows. And these three green arrows are all pointing to sediment. This means that all three of these kinds of rocks can be weathered and eroded away to become sediment. So the grit and sand grains and dirt grains that you see called sediment, those are all from little bits and pieces of any of these three types of rocks. But only one type of rock is formed when the sediment is squished together to form a rock. And so when we use sediment to create a rock, we call it a sedimentary rock. So overall, this is the rock cycle, and you should be able to explain it. You might want to practice drawing it on your own without looking to see how much you remember, because you may see a question on a test or a quiz asking you to explain the process of the rock cycle. And this is the end of lesson 22.